whatever you're capable of doing as artists to help propagandize the civil rights revolution.
Out of that came the true artistry of Harry Belafonte.
I try to envision playing out the rest of my life almost exclusively devoted to reflection. But is this too much of the world to be done?
Harry Belafonte, welcome to the show. Tell us a little bit about how the idea came about. Who came to you and said, it's time for us to make a documentary about you?
The idea has always bounced around the walls of my space. And it was always put in a suggestion that I talk about my life. And I just got very conflicted about that. When you have enjoyed the kind of platform that I and others have enjoyed that become celebrity, so much of it is about, it's so narcissistic. I just don't have an appetite for that. But what happened in this instance was that one of my best friends died, Marlon Brando, and outside of a great loss of a friend, I was very much aware of the fact that he took off without everybody really knowing his deeper story. And then I began to look beyond just Marlon and saw that so many people had passed away from my time, my space, my generation, and they never really left behind a deeper understanding of the time in which we lived from our perspective. Mm-hmm. So with a little push from my daughter, Gita, who was always nudging me, and I'd say to him, I don't want to get on a screen and start just talking about myself. It sounds self-serving. And she says, well, let those of us who will edit this thing make sure that that doesn't happen.
Did anything surprise you about you when you saw the final edit of the movie?
I think almost all of it did. I really do, because I understand that opportunity knocked at the door and I made conscious choice to receive those who came to look and to find. Eleanor Roosevelt walked into my life outside of an enormous admiration for her and her husband. I was born in the time of the Great Depression and lived through all that that meant, to all of a sudden in my young adulthood have this lady call on me because she says, I have something that I'm trying to get done and only you can help me.
Well, very good Eleanor Roosevelt.
Oh, yeah. It's a terrible Eleanor Roosevelt. When she opened her life to me and said, I need your help, it was an astounding invitation, overwhelming. And with her as an example, people like Paul Robeson, one of the great cultural icons of my time, an African-American who paid a huge price for his strength and his integrity and the way he stood up against injustice. And then Dr. King, who was 24 years old, who picked up the phone and called one day. And when I responded to these moments, I didn't quite understand what it was that I would be doing, except that if I could serve, I would do that.
When you think of your film career, what is there a scene or a particular movie that you look back on with a lot of resonance that has meaning to you?
I have to say in all honesty that all of it has resonance and meaning, because I never came to a film just dealing with the tools of the play. There was other mission that weighed terribly on me, because every time I looked for what it was that I thought I could do, I was being told by everyone, America had no appetite for stories of that kind. I'm always required to go on the screen to do what others perceive black people did. There was this fixed vision for us by those who knew very little about us. And as a matter of fact, it was a huge part of fueling why I went into the civil rights movement. Because everywhere I looked, among a lot of very decent people that made up the Hollywood culture, they did not seem to hear my voice. They did not seem to hear what we were trying to say. They did not see the us of our time. So the way to fix that is to change the way America thinks.
The last thing I ask everybody that comes here is, and it's really hilarious that I'm asking it of you, but I ask somebody to sing a little bit of a song that's expressing what's in their head right now.
It's easy.
Okay.
Deo, deo, daylight come and me wa, go home. De, mi sede, mi sede, mi sede, mi sede, mi sede. Daylight come and me wa, go home. The miracle of that song is that, first of all, it's in the tradition of Woody Guthrie, although it comes from another culture. It's about working people who suffer fiercely, working on the plantations without very much reward economically. The song says all that. And for this peasant song to come from the recesses of a developing country, lost somewhere out there, to have wended its way into the forefront of popular culture, that today you can't go to a New York Yankees game and not hear "Dale" as the rallying cry. This song has wended its way to the forefront of imagination. People don't even know who sang it, what one song could do, and what platform it gave to one individual to use that platform to say all the things that I'm here running my mouth saying. You know, it's a miracle. It's a great place to be.
Harry, Deo, right back at you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.